I'm going to narrow it down to my experience at Tehelka and to speak specifically about the media context in India. You know, I think a very important distinction got made earlier today about the difference between the way we were colonized by the British Empire and what America is doing to all of us as societies. Particularly in India, I think the impact of America on Indian media is very different from the way the British colonized our minds. What America has done to us is not oppressive. There is the danger of self-capitulation. They have seduced us. Today, every idea of pleasure, dreams, wish fulfillment, ambition, aesthetic, everything is defined by the American paradigm. And that is not something that has been oppressed or brought onto us by force, but certainly one of seduction. And I think the seduction has also arisen out of the mistakes of the past in our own societies. Today, American society, American civilization has unleashed a genie that I don't think can be put back into the bottle, and that is the genie of individualism, which Dr. Shad spoke about earlier. And I think that is a creative force, and we have to grapple with it, not just critically, not just demonize it, but to grapple with it very, very creatively. And that is the only way in which we will be able to combat this seduction and set up something else which weans us away, not merely demonizes the American society, but weans us away from whatever is destructive about it. In Indian media, since the 1990s, there's been a distinct shift in the nature of Indian media, and it manifests itself in every aspect of our lives. And I'm going to very quickly give you some aspects in which this is playing out. It is true that through forums like the Indo-US CEO forum, almost every aspect of our lives today is being dictated by America. But that again is being played out by the Indian media on many fault lines that define Indian society today. When we are talking about hegemony, the biggest hegemony in India today is the divide, the fault line between the urban and the rural. And that urban today is what I was talking about yesterday, and I've repeatedly been trying to bring to everyone's notice, is the capacity for self-criticism, that today we are the enemy. You know, the enemy is within us. We replicate everything that we dislike about American society, and certainly the elites in every society is that. And until we develop this capacity for self-criticism, we are not going to be able to eliminate that. So in India, in Indian media, the big fault line is the urban versus the rural. Today in all reportage, and you know, both of you mentioned this in terms of what we focus on, what we omit is there. A big fault line in India today is the conflict over land. As India moves from an agricultural to an industrial society, we are doing what the colonies, what the imperialist countries did to the colonies. We are doing to our own country in an era of 24/7 technology and media. And we're doing it in a time when political rhetoric is very different. And there is actually fires all across our country. If you were watching Indian media, English-speaking media, you would see none of that. Because none of that, barring perhaps Tehelka and a few smaller you know, niche journals, are not documenting it at all. The rhetoric is completely capitalist. When there are land conflicts where indigenous people are holding on to their land and corporates are taking it over, it is seen as something disruptive. It is seen as something anarchic. There's one particular land conflict that all of you might be familiar with, which was the Tata factory in Singur. Across the world and in Indian media, it was reported as something that was retrogressive. You know, the people on the ground who were resisting it were seen as regressive. Mr. Ratan Tata, who's the sort of toasted icon of the world, sent a letter to the people of Bengal telling them to be more disciplined and to be more amenable to development. Again, it is only journals like Tehelka which are going deeper and raising the questions of justice that underlie all this. In doing that, I personally doggedly feel that we have to arrive at a language that goes beyond discussions of capitalism and socialism and communism, because all of these have made historical mistakes. And when you speak within the framework of any of these isms, there are too many people whose internal monologues are pointing out all the mistakes that, say, socialist communities have made or communist communities have made, or like today, capitalism is rampantly making. And I think we have to find a new language which is purely about transactional justice, which is about values that, you know, your opponents can understand. And if we doggedly speak this language, I think somebody earlier said that you can't reform America. I don't think that's possible, because if you foreclose the possibility of reform, I think as a media organization, as communicators, you know, you're trapping yourselves in a kind of black hole. The other big fault line where Indian media is again replicating the Muslim rhetoric, the American rhetoric, is on the Hindu-Muslim fault lines in India. And the reason why I'm going to keep bringing up Tehelka as an example of resistance is that that resistance is very, very firmly located in a sort of independent space. And it is not located in raising one bogey against another bogey. It is not harking back to some golden past. It is very, very firmly seeking a new language. We've done a lot of seminal work in actually diffusing the kind of anti-Muslim wave that was sweeping over India. And it's not just because we exposed what happened in the Gujarat riots, but I think more critically and more importantly, we took up a case called the Simmi case in India. Every time that there was a terror blast in India, within hours, the Indian media would say, the Simmi has done it. The Simmi is a students' Islamic Muslim organization, very radical in their political views, angry, insistent on Muslim identity. But and perhaps they have cells where they have taken recourse to militant action. But certainly the cases that we examined, there was no evidence to prove that the young Muslim boys who were being picked up were in any way associated with the terror blast. And we raised the purely evidential question that how is it that when you did not know who was going to trigger these blasts, how is it that 5 hours later you have closed the case and you know who the mastermind is and you've picked up these 7 boys? And and also there's been this cascading masterminds, it relies on the idea that on an average an Indian or anyone across the globe who's non-Islamic will not be able to distinguish from one long Islamic name to another. And so they've trotted out masterminds one after the other, and the media swallows it and moves on. But again, when we did this, when we did this 3-month investigation into the Simmi and the nature of the Simmi, we were very careful not to couch this purely in terms of whitewashing all Islamic organizations or Muslim boys, but to keep it on the non-negotiable ground of evidence and of justice. And I think that has stood us in very good stead. Because we have, by our dislike of communal politics, we have naturally been adversaries of the Hindu right-wing party in India, which is the BJP. But in 10 years of being adversaries of the BJP, today the BJP speaks to us. In fact, there was a big cataclysm in the BJP where last year, I think, there was their patriarch, which was a man called L.K. Advani, stepped down. And there was a lot of discussion about what the identity of this Hindutva party would be, this ultra-right-wing Hindu party would be, because it seems the mood in India is moving away from communal politics. And the interesting thing is that the essay that triggered a political cataclysm in that party was published in Tehelka by a BJP insider. And the why I'm reiterating all this is that if we are going to combat the hegemonies that we dislike, we have to be very, very careful of not falling into the same trap and the same logic and the same language that we dislike, whether it comes from America or from within us. Again, one of the things that I want to, the elephant in the room that I think a lot of us are not talking about, is the space of women in all our societies. And when I spoke of the creative impulse that has been unleashed by Western civilization, it is an individualism, it is also in the place of women in society. We saw in Howard Zinn's film yesterday that women have really had to fight for their place in Western society, for basic things like the right to vote, the right to work. Feminism has been much more militant in Western societies than in India, for example, where actually, certainly in the Hindu tradition, women have been extremely celebrated. They have been seen as the primary force that triggers nature, that triggers the male principle, all of that. But in societal terms, women have been oppressed and women have been subjected to the idea of collective duty, the idea of modesty. Why the idea of modesty should lie in the male gaze rather than women's comfort zone with what they wear. Today, if I were to describe what modesty is, I would say it is what I'm comfortable wearing with, not what my father dictates, not what my brother is comfortable with, and certainly not what the male gaze dictates. So why I'm saying this is that today Indian media is the conglomeration of the worst of American society and the worst of Indian society. And why is that? Because in the issue of women, it is appalling that Indian media, particularly urban English-speaking media, will get itself into a froth over something like the murder, and these are important issues. I'm not again saying that those are illegitimate issues, but recently they have been in a froth over the murder of a waitress in an urban bar. They have been in a froth over a police officer eve teasing a young urban girl. But the Indian media is completely blind and will blot out rapes that are going on in a huge scale in tribal areas of India, where poor women are being suppressed, where young girls are in rural areas are either coming under sort of age-old collective communal behavior, like, you know, I don't know how familiar you are with the idea of the Khap Panchayat, but this is like a Hindu elders, a group of elders who dictate that you cannot marry across community, you cannot marry across caste, there are things that women can't do and young men can't do. And the Indian media will not be on a froth over those issues, or again, in an equally dangerous way, they will completely black it out from a completely Western perspective. You know, there's no attempt to understand it in a cultural context and to take it on within the idiom of what the this happens largely in the Indian Western state of Haryana, for instance. They will not speak in a language where a Haryanvi elder can engage with me. You know, you'll discard it as something that is just has no place in civilized society. You will not dare to engage with it, or you will not engage, or you'll just blot it out. So in all these ways, in our idiom, in our concerns, in our ideas of pleasure, in our ideas of duty, in our ideas of human rights and what is right and wrong, American society has seeped into us. But the counter is that what India stands for, what, you know, and India is a conglomeration again, or a synthesis of Muslim society, Christian, Hindu, so it's difficult to really say what Indian society stands for. I'm saying that the counter logic to that is not very positive. The other place in which, again, American mindset dictates Indian media is in the way we cover corporate issues. Across the board, Indian media is subservient, servile, you know, absolutely slavish in the way it covers corporates. If there's a big corporate CEO on Indian television, you'd imagine this was the old paid patronage, the courtiers of the Indian court sort of singing paeans to the monarch. You know, that is the way, say, a Ratan Tata or a Ellen Mittal or a Daewoo CEO is interviewed by the Indian media. And the reason for that, again, is that post-1990s, our salaries, our idea of pleasure, and I want to reiterate that our idea of pleasure has been taken over by consumerism. Today, Indian media is paid, while it's on a downslide everywhere else in the world, our salaries are huge, our offices are more plush than you can ever imagine. And the very logic, the structural logic of Indian media has been taken over by corporates. It is impossible for Tehelka. It has been, it is one man's act of will, Tarun Tejpal, who I started Tehelka with. He has just survived on the one maxim that I'd rather lose the ship than become something else. So it's really been individual will. We've also functioned on the idea that we'll take the rich man's money and use it to tell the stories of the poor. We make no commercial sense. Our balance sheets are always in the red. And there is no commercial reason why Tehelka lives. It lives because of an individual will. And I think if we're going to combat a lot of things that happen, it will have to be on individual will. But having said that, there are certain things that do need to change. I'm sort of jumping stuff, but I'll come back to some more things I want to say. But on structural issues, for instance, again, because we are trapped in this logic of capitalism and the mistakes of a socialist past, which was ridden by the license Raj, where people who were allowed to give licenses were so corrupt, that today capitalism does seem to be the more democratic option. In Indian media, it is impossible to be independent anymore, because just to distribute a television channel, we have to pay something like 80 crores to the cable operators. When you have to pay 80 crores annually to a cable operator, it is impossible to be independent. That's 800 million rupees. It is impossible to be independent, because there will be only two or three men who will say on an individual will that I'd rather let my ship sink than become something else. So in fact, we have to start talking about structural changes to Indian media or to media anywhere else in the world.